Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Smile, you made it out. You made it here, everyone, please. It's supposed to stop snowing about noon, and then it'll be spring again by tomorrow. This will all be just a bad dream, right? You're not believing the word I'm saying. I'm sure it'll be warm up at least by July. All right, let's stand, let's sing. Welcome to First Baptist Church. Glad you can be with us here this morning. Garrett is home recouping this morning. He had knee surgery earlier this week, so he is, I hear he's going to be working at IHOP next week. The spirit is alive here today. How you doing? Yeah. to take his place in glory. He knew what was coming that week, but yet he rode in to fulfill out his mission, to do what he was born to do, to save us from our sin. Amen? We're going to do it only for the good here. This seems appropriate for Palm Sunday as well, because our promise is built on a risen Savior. Amen?
Amen.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let His praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God.
Of Christ our King. We
invested, we continue to remember the Stanley family in our prayer. We said our words to Jeff yesterday that we will see him sometime. Not goodbye, but we'll see you once again. The promises of God, Christ our King. We're trusting in his promises of eternal that are there for each and every one of us, that we can embrace him for who he is in our life. We find strength in knowing that Christ is what? Faithful. Faithful to his promises. And we can trust him in every circumstance, situation. And so, Father, we come before your throne this morning and we say thank you. Thank you, Lord, that no matter what we're going through, you are there. You remind us, Lord, of your great love and your compassion, Lord, has no end. We thank you, Lord, for the mercy and grace you pour out upon us. And Lord, you demonstrated your love, Father, by sending your Son to stand in our place. Lord, we thank you as we come on this Palm Sunday day, the triumphant entry, Lord, of Christ our King. And Lord, we pray this morning, Lord, that we would look to him, who is the author and finisher of our faith, that we would look to him for strength, guidance, and direction. That we would believe, Lord, that he hears the prayers of his sons and daughters. That he is a God who is able to take that that is broken, Lord, and make it whole again. He's a restorer, Lord, of those things, Lord, that seem impossible for us, but nothing's impossible for him. Lord, we come this morning. We humble ourselves, Lord, before you and say, Lord, we want you to be God in our life. We want you, Lord, help us, Lord, to surrender all things unto you that you might be glorified, Lord, in our coming and in our going. We pray today, Lord, and thank you, Lord, that you are our healer and strength. And though we pray, Lord, for a healing that does not always come on this side, but it definitely comes when we enter into your presence. The things, Lord, in life, they come. But Lord, when we look to you, author and finisher of our faith, we find hope for today and that for tomorrow. And so, Lord, we come. And we ask, Lord, that you administer, Lord, to the Stanley family, Lord, and to the Breed families, Lord, in our body of going through this community, Lord. It seems like, Lord, over the past few months, Lord, someone dear and precious to us, Lord, has received their reward. And Lord, it's just a reminder, Lord, that we're born unto death. But Lord, we're also born unto life because of who you are. And so we come. We believe, Lord, that you're God, and you've heard the prayers, Lord, as people had gathered, Lord, for the past 40 days to pray to you, Lord, and ask you, Lord, to move upon numerous things, Lord, as we went through the 40-day time of prayer for our city, for our county, for our neighbors, for those, Lord, across the sea, to the other nations, Lord. We pray, Lord, that you would be glorified and lives would be touched because of you, Lord. And we're believing, Lord, that where two or three had gathered, Lord, believing and trusting, Lord, in you, that you heard the prayers of your children, Lord, as we've been going through the 21 days of preparation, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we would believe, Lord, that you're hearing the prayers of your sons and daughters. And then the word tells us, Lord, that you moved when the prayers came into your presence, Lord. We're believing, Lord, that homes and lives, Lord, would be restored. Lord, and that who saying that there was no hope for them would find this great hope in him who is able. His name is Jesus. And so, Lord, we come today. We lift up America to you and the nations of the world. That they would see, Lord, hallelujah, that without God, there is no victory. There is no overcoming power. There is no law, government that is able to take that that is broken and make it whole. It's only through God, who's all kingdoms and all things set upon his shoulders. Lord, and so we come to you today and we say, Lord, have mercy on us. Forgive us, Lord, when we think that we can put something together that will cause lives and people to change. That people would know how to love one another, Lord, because we call it this love day, hug day. Oh, Lord, we need you to touch our hearts and touch our lives, that we might know how to love the unlovable. Oh, Lord, teach us, Lord, how to love one another as you have loved us. And so we come today, Lord, not like them who have no faith. We're believing, Lord, because of a few gathering, Lord, all around this nation, across the seas, believing for that 40 days of prayer, those who are faithful and during the 21 days of preparation, those who are setting things aside, Lord, and saying, Lord, we just want to get closer to you, Lord. Let us believe and pray, Lord, with a great expectation that you hear and you will touch our lives. And so now, Lord, we ask that you would touch everyone under the sound of my voice. Help us, Lord, heal us, guide us, and direct us, Lord. Draw us ever closer, Lord, and nearer to you. And Lord, we'll be mindful to give you all praise, give you all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Let's give the Lord praise this morning. We have a busy week coming up on us. And we thank God for the children of God. And we thank God for his son. We'll be meeting Thursday at 7 o'clock. And I know Mike is going to share these things, but I'm going to share them. We want you to come out and be part of it. And as you look around today and there be some that are not here, let them know we're meeting Monday, Thursday service. We got something special, something different this year. We're going to be meeting down in the fellowship hall. And we invite you to come and be part of that ministry, what God is doing, as we go through this time of passion, that we go through this time of understanding God's promises becoming alive. We'll be meeting on Friday, Good Friday, at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. And I know that some may think these are the things that we always do, and it's the same thing. But it's never the same thing when you're doing Jesus. He has something new every morning. Every morning. And so we ask that you would call your neighbor, call your brothers and sisters, and say, let us pack the house. Let us come and fellowship together with one another. We also will be doing again the Community Area Ministerial Alliance. Cam and group will be meeting on Good Friday for the crosswalk. We did that last year. And this year we'll be meeting again at Trinity Lutheran Church this year. And we'll be meeting at 11:45 and we'll begin the walk. And we're only going to walk this year from 11:45 to 1 o'clock. We walked for hours last year. And we're going to be carrying the cross. We're going to be praying at different stations, and we're going to believe God to begin to move. There was a lot of questions by people last year when they saw the cross being carried, and they wanted to know, what is that all about? But we were telling them about the goodness and the good news of Jesus, the meaning of what, thank God, this Friday is all about. It's about God's love for mankind, that he sent his son to take our place. And so we encourage you, those of you that can, we ask you to meet with us at 11:45 and have that time of prayer as we meet at the different locations throughout the city. And we're going to believe God for a great time in him. And so that is Friday at 11:45. We will begin at Trinity Lutheran Church, 301 East Chestnut, right behind us. We thank God this morning for each and every one of you. One more. If some of you are hard of hearing and you have trouble hearing things that have been spoken to you today. I was talking to Dick Anderson, and Dick said that there are phones available. The government has phones that are available for those who have impaired hearing. And he says these phones work magnificently. He said, in fact, his granddaughter calls him and she talks real fast and he still can't understand everything. He said, there's a button that slows the voice down so you can hear it. That may make some of you who have hearing want to get one of those phones. But Dick has a number and we'll be getting that number here at the church. And he says, and there's some paperwork and those things there, but he's had his for 3 years and just got a new phone. And they also have them for cell phones and those things there that you can be in contact. And he says, and it even shows the light on it, the stand, that when his cell phone is ringing, he can see that and he can hear everything that is spoken. And so, those of you, you might want to that you can hear when someone is talking to you on the phone. Amen. Amen. As we prepare our hearts this morning to give, let us be faithful in our giving. We thank God today for all He's done for us. And we thank God that He has blessed us, that we can give back a portion to that He has given to us. And so as the ushers come and wait upon us this morning, let us give with a glad heart, a thankful heart, of the goodness of God and all that He has done for us and what He's doing in us. Ushers, would you come now and wait upon us?
I don't know how to play that. I switch on a different instrument every week. I don't know what to do. work on this. We need to work on this. Okay, but you know what? The city gates, this is where everybody comes into the city. And so today, we are expecting a very special guest. A king. A king. A king. A king. Yes. A king. King Jesus. King Jesus. Now, what would be so exciting about a king coming to visit? With Jesus coming to visit. What do you think would be exciting about that? I'm putting you on the spot. What's exciting about a king coming? There's lots of, like, you know, if you're a pretty important person, right? I mean, that's pretty big. I mean, normally they've got, well, let's look in today's standards. You got, like, security. I mean, they're checking things out, making sure everybody's safe, right? And they clear the roads. And people might be lining the streets waiting for this special person to come. I mean, it's a pretty big deal. Everyone knows what's going on, and when they come through, it's a big deal, right? It's a big deal, yeah. Well, Jesus entered Jerusalem in kind of like a parade, and people were so excited that he was coming. They heard about all the amazing miracles that Jesus had done and how he showed love to every single person he came into contact with. And they all wanted to follow Jesus, those people that he came into contact with. So what ended up happening was that people stood on both sides of the road and they shouted praises at him and they cheered for him and they had these, can I have you sit forward just a smidge, buddy? And they had palm branches that they would wave. And so, you know, remember Wednesday night, you guys had decorated some palm leaves? And I'm going to have you check some of these out. What are some of the praises that are written on these palm leaves? Check those out. Caleb, do you know what yours says? It says, I love
you.
What? Jesus. I love Jesus. Very good. How about her, Shelly? What does it say?
Hosanna.
Go Jesus. What does it say? What do yours say, Caleb?
Jesus.
Praise Jesus. Awesome. Is there another one there? Another go Jesus. Alleluia. Hosanna. Awesome. Jesus. Just saying Jesus' name is awesome. That's right. Yes, so these are some of the phrases. Jesus is the best.
Jesus is best.
Jesus is the best. Amen. So the people thought Jesus was coming to be their king here on earth, and they thought he'd defeat the Romans, ruled all over them, and then they'd be free to rule themselves. They wouldn't have anybody in charge of them. They were so excited. So they laid palm branches on the road in front of Jesus. They laid their coats on the road as he passed by just to honor him. And then all the people started shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, which means save us. Shout that cheer with me. You guys ready? We're going to say Hosanna. Hosanna! Hosanna! I think we need the congregation to help us out. What do you think? So few of us. Okay, you ready? On three. Hosanna, Hosanna. One, two, three.
Hosanna!
Amen, amen. Well, here is your opportunity. We are going to line the streets of the center aisles of the sanctuary. Just to practice. Now, let's be real for a second, okay? I need you guys, let's be real. I'll be real for a second. Is it hard to let go of ourselves sometimes and just start shouting praises and start waving things in the air and just let go? Is that hard or is that easy? It's hard. It might be easy for some, right? But for some of us, it's hard. I'm starting to let loose. I got a long way to go. But you know what? There is something very freeing about just letting go and just, yes. Just waving your hands in the air and close your eyes and just focus on Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So let's try that today. Let's line the streets of the center aisles, you guys. Can you help me? And congregation, I need some help on this because we got a small crew up here today. So grab some palm branches. And we're going to practice our cheers. Let's practice our cheers. Yeah, there's some, you guys, do you want a regular palm branch? You can have a regular palm branch if you want. Okay, let's line up. Let's sit on here and line the aisles, and we're just going to shout, Hosanna, Hosanna, we're going to practice. Let's practice letting loose. Hosanna! Hosanna! King Jesus! So Jesus!
Jesus!
Hallelujah! And Jesus was really human. How cool that would be?
Jesus!
What do you think? Jesus!
Jesus!
Thank you.
Let him hear you.
Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord.
peace in heaven and glory in the highest. And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, Teacher, rebuke your disciples. And he answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones will cry out. Father, we thank you today. Because, Lord, we thank you that the Father is not ashamed of us who have put our faith in you. You know how unrighteous your children sometimes can be. How we, Lord, can get off track. And yet, when Father looks at us, he looks at us through your lens, and he finds no fault. We come this morning, Lord, and we thank you, Jesus, for your love, the love that you pour out, Lord. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this Palm Sunday, Lord, that you announce to all that you are the Messiah. You are Hosanna in the highest. And so, Lord, we praise you this morning. We thank you, Lord, for all that you are and all that you have done. We ask, Lord, that you would help us, Lord, break free from the chains that keep us from praising you and exalting you, establishing you, Lord, as Lord in our lives and all that we say and do. We ask that you give us ears to hear, our heart to receive, and then, Lord, we pray for the boldness and the courage to manifest your glory before all men. And we ask your blessing now, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. We want to talk to you today about will a rock take your place. When I thought about the message, I thought about that scripture in verse 40. And he answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. And I tell you, and another translation said, I tell you that if these just keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out. In the Word of God, it tells us that if the children of God will not praise him, all that God has created would. If you would not lift up your voices to praise him, all of creation would begin to praise him in your place. So my question is, would you have a stone replace you? Would you allow a rock to take your place? The trees raised their branches unto the Lord. The birds sang unto the Lord. But it is we who he has given eternal life. And the question is, will you be silent in the presence of a living God? Will you not allow God to take you to the place where you can never get to on your own? When we look at the Word this morning, we're seeing this triumphant entry. In fact, Pastor Lucas described in all four books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, of the Gospel. You'll find it in Matthew, chapter 21. You'll find the beginning in Mark in chapter 11. In Luke chapter 19. And in John chapter 12. And it begins with this triumphant entry into that begins on Palm Sunday. And what Jesus is doing is fulfilling the scriptures that we find in Zechariah chapter 9. And so when we talk about him entering in, we saw that shed and as our brother came in. And I praise God as I saw you line up and we participated in showing the children that you're not ashamed to be children of God. That you entered in and said to them, God has set us free and we want to be free in the things of God. And I praise you for that. But here the challenge comes to each and every one of us as believers in Christ. Will we lay it all down for his glory? And we find in the scripture, in Mark chapter 10, it tells us in verse 32 these words, And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them, and they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles, and they will mock him, spit on him, flog him, kill him, and after 3 days he will rise." We find in the scriptures that as Jesus is entering into the city, he's aware of everything that is going on. In fact, he tells the disciples, "We're going." And they were afraid because they knew that if they would enter into the city, they knew that people were out to kill Jesus, and they were afraid not only for Jesus' life, but they were afraid for their own lives. And so the scripture says that they were afraid. And Jesus said to them, "But we're going. But we're going." And the importance of that is when we look at the scriptures that Jesus said to them, and this is the third time that he had mentioned to them that he is going to, that he had foretold his death. And so he said to them, "We're going. We're going." And you can imagine how he said it. Have you ever had your children, you're taking them to a place, and it may have been when they're little, and maybe in the 10 years, and you said to them, "Get up, get moving, we're going to church." And they gave you that look. And you had to say to them, "We're going. You're going." And that's what he said to them. "We're going, children. We're going." They were thinking about Jesus. If you go, they'll stop everything that you have planned. You are the King of Kings. But if they kill you, how then will we be set free? How will we be set free? And so as we look at the scriptures, we find that there was a fear within them. And yet Jesus describes everything that would happen. And over the next few days, we'll begin to talk about those things as he gathered with them, and as he was taken prisoner, and as they beat him and hung him on a tree. That the scriptures that were written, he was fulfilling. And we know that this Jesus shows us our love in John chapter 3. It says, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." And then the scriptures here, it tells us what? That as Moses lifted up the serpent, for people to become whole, Jesus would have to begin to be lifted up if people want to have life. That he would be lifted up, and those that will look to Jesus, what they will be saved from death. That's what he's saying to us. So when Jesus says to them, "I gotta go, and we are going," it tells us in scripture that God had a plan. And when we read John 3, we're always talking about God's love for us. And so when Jesus is saying to them, "I'm going to Jerusalem," when he's riding in on the donkey, he is saying to them, "I love you. I love you. And I am the King of Kings and the King of Glory. I am the one that is able to set you free." And it goes on to say in John 3, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him may be saved. So would you have a rock take your place?" See, sometimes when we begin to think about worship and thinking about praising God, beginning to get out of ourselves and let God move, we hear all the people say, "Let the Spirit just move in your life." What they're saying is that, get your eyes fixed on Jesus. Because without Jesus, there is no life. And sometimes we think that we're dignified. There is not one dignified person in this place. Not one. Because why? There's times that you cut up. You laugh and you joke. You get down on the floor with the grandbabies, this and that and the other. You just make a clown out of yourself, and you'll even make the faces and do all of those things there to make someone laugh. You're not worried about being dignified. You're about living. And yet when it comes to the things of God, we want to be dignified. We want to be dignified. And Jesus is saying, I want you to be alive. And if you're going to be dignified, I want you to identify with who I am, that you might be set free. Because see, when Christ comes into our lives, he takes the least of us, and he presents us before the Holy One. And it's not about us being dignified, it's about him being holy. It's never about our character, it's about his character that is in us. And so all of these things are about him coming into the city. And so when we begin to look at the scriptures, we see in John chapter 12, it talks about the next day, Jesus had been with his friends and Martha and Lazarus, Mary. He had been with them. And it says that the next day, a great multitude had come to the feast. And when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, they took branches and palm trees, and they went out to meet him and cried out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, King of Israel. And Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, he sat on it. And as it was written, Fear not, daughters of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. His disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written about him and that they had done these things to him. See, sometimes we don't get it. We don't understand. But the word of God was written about him. From Genesis to Revelation, it's always been about Jesus. God had a plan before he said, let there be, that one day he would send the Word who would become flesh and he would dwell among us. God had a plan for each and every one of us that we might begin to see and understand God's love for us. That we would want to praise him with everything that is in us because why? He loves us so. And so when it says this thing, it said their eyes were open. Because why? It was after Christ had died on the cross, as he rose from the dead, they began to understand. So we as believers today, should we not then have a clearer view of why Christ came, why he rode in, why he has done the things he does, and then why he has called us to do the things he has commanded? Because he loves us. He's trying to show us that there are promises of God that are real and they're for each and every one of us. It says they did not understand these things at first, but when Jesus was glorified, they remembered. And then in verse 17 it said, therefore the people who were with him when he called Lazarus out from his tomb and raised him from the dead, they bore witness. For this reason, the people also met him, because they heard that he had done these great things, these wonderful signs. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, you say that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after him. They heard about what Jesus has done. They were there because they heard about them raising Lazarus from the dead. And some of them got out there and they were there because they heard that he was coming. Because it said the disciples went before him. And the people began to understand Jesus is coming into the city. And then began to shout and they began to praise him. And they began to shout these things, not understanding what they were shouting about. Have you ever been in a crowd and you said, what's going on? What's going on? And that's what they were doing. What's going on? They said, it's Jesus. He's coming. Who's he? Who is Jesus? They said, he's the one who raised Lazarus from the dead. We heard about that. We heard about what Jesus had done. And then he said, it's Jesus. The one who raised Lazarus. It's Jesus. Who does the miracles. It's Jesus. And it said the crowds began to grow. And they began to grow. It may have been just a trickle of saints, but all of a sudden, the road was covered. and people began to praise him. They began to shout unto him. They began to lift up their voices to him. They began to call on him and began to say, God, Hosanna, glory to God. Hosanna, who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel, sitting on a donkey. When we look at the text reminds us that Jesus said to the disciples, if someone should ask you why they're getting and taking the colt, you say to them, the Lord has need of it. What he said to them that day was, I am the Lord. I am the King of Kings, the Lord of glory. Tell them the Lord wants it. And when he told them, and the person asked him who owned the colt, said, what are you doing with my colt? They said, the Lord has need of it. We never hear another word. It says they took the colt and they brought the colt to Jesus. There's something about when we begin to understand that the Lord is in the presence. The Lord, the Spirit of God, dwells within us. Shouldn't it be then at that time that we begin to say, glory to God in the highest, that he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Should we not begin to say, it's no longer I that lives, but it is he that lives in me? Should we not begin to understand that it was Jesus, the Savior, the Messiah, who loves, who came from heaven, come down as a man, and he is coming for us. For us. That he is desiring us to know him and the power of his resurrection. He's wanting us to know him in such a mighty way. And it said that the people began to, on the crowd, and they began to shout out to him. But there's those that were in the crowd that didn't get it. They didn't get it. They didn't understand it. In fact, the scriptures go on to say that not only did they not get it, in Matthew 21 and verse 10 it said this, when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up and saying, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. Not the Lord, not the King of Glory, not the Lord of Lords, not Hosanna in the highest, but he's the prophet. He's the prophet. They understood that he was a great teacher. In fact, the word says that no one expounded on the word like he did. In fact, they said that about him when he was 12. That he even confounded them when he sat there with the teachers and began to ask them questions that they could not answer. And he expounded on them and began to share with them things, and they were wowed by the fact that he could understand these things. And it says that when he was lost as a child and the parents had been gone, Mary and Joseph had been gone for 3 days, and they realized Jesus was not with them. It says that they came back and they said, Jesus, do you know that you had us worried? Your father and I have been looking for you. He says, my father is in heaven, the King of Glory. That's who Jesus is. Sometimes when we look at our salvation and begin to talk about what God has done, we begin to talk as if we don't know him. The people in the group said they didn't know him. They said, who is he? And the best that they could say was that, well, he's the prophet from Nazareth. And you remember one of the disciples said, what good thing comes out of Nazareth? What happens in Fulton County? Come on. Yeah. Where you at? I'm from Fulton County. Where's that at? 50 years ago, I ran in the Drake Relays. And they were announcing off the teams, and they talked about the teams that were there, and the Texas A&M, Florida A&M. They talked about these different schools where all the track people that were lining up in their lanes. And then they said this. And Spoon River College, Canton, Illinois. how they announced it. They boomed it out about the other schools. Even when they got to Chicago, they boomed that out. And then they said, Canton, Illinois. That's what they were saying about Jesus. Who is he? Who is he? And if somebody asked you today, how would you begin to say it? Would you shout it out and say, he is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of glory. He is my Savior. Or would you fight for words and speak as if you didn't know who he is? Would you speak in such a way that people would not begin to believe that you are part of him? See, we live in a day right now, the challenge for each and every one of us is that the King of glory is continuing to move. The Spirit of God is in this place. And he is wanting us to be about him in every circumstance, situation of our lives. He's wanting us to touch him and let him touch us. But if someone would ask you, what is your reason for doing the things you do? Would you talk about him and begin to say about him that he is my King? He's the King of glory. He is the one that they have spoken about. He is the Savior of my life. Would you begin to tell them about all the magnificent things he has done for you? How he's brought you along the way, how he's picked you up and turned you around, set your feet on the solid ground. Would you talk about the goodness of what God has done in you? See, that's what it was about. The crowd was talking about these things. They were shouting and they were saying all the right things, but they didn't understand who this Jesus was. Who this Jesus is. And yet the disciples did not get it all. And they've been walking with them for 3 years and did not understand it all. And yet, my question is, as long-time believers, would we be willing to stand up and shout out to everyone about who Jesus is for you? And then with the same boldness say to them, he could be that Jesus also for you. For each and every one that we come in contact with. Because if the Word of God tells us about it, that we're to go into all the world and preach the gospel, we're to begin to shout and praise him about all the great things he has done and what he's able to do to someone like us. Undignified, nothing special, sheep of sinners. That he's able to pick us up and turn our lives completely around. Will we be able to speak over the rocks have to cry out? Will they have to speak in our place about the glory of God and what he has done? We talk about the creation, we look at all of the things, and you go to SeaWorld and you see all of the things in the sea, and you ooh and ah. And all he said was, let there be. Let it be. And instantly, the sea was filled. When you look at the beautifulness of the birds and hear them chirping, all of those things, it said, all he said was, let there be. And the sky was filled with all flying creatures. He said, let there be. The beautifulness of that we see on the ground and the flowers that come, all of those things, he just spoke it into existence. But he says, if you will not praise me, they will praise me. If you will not exalt me, they will exalt me. The birds will sing praises unto me. The tree will lift its branches. The stones will cry out. And he said, immediately, they will not even hesitate. They will do that because they recognize who I am. In fact, scripture even goes on to say that all creation groans and waiting for his return. It says to us, as beautiful as those flowers are, when the glory of God comes, the flowers will be even more beautiful than we have ever imagined in our life. The clearness and the beauty of the flower will be such. And he says, right now, you think this is beautiful. This is beauty under sin. But when I come back, everything will change. Everything will be different. And you will see things like you've never seen it before. That's who they were shouting to. That's what they were shouting about. Jesus, our Savior, the one who loves us, the one who cares about us, that says that we matter to him. And so it was those that were there. There was those that were talking about him because why he had raised Lazarus from the grave. And then when we talk about that story of Lazarus, we remember that both sisters said, Jesus, had you been here, we know our brother would be alive today. He was just really, really sick. In fact, Jesus got the word. He said, Lazarus is sick. And then it said he tarried. He waited. Lazarus is sick, should we go check on him? Not yet. Not yet. Okay, let's go. Lazarus doing better? No, he's dead. He's dead. He said, yeah, now let's go. He got the word while Lazarus was still alive. He could have went and did something. But when he got there, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. For 4 days. Laying in a tomb. And they talked to him, oh Lord, had you been here? And then once the sister said, Lord, we know that you are the resurrection. What he was saying is, we know that you are the king. We know that you are the one we praise. You are the King of Israel. You are the Messiah. We know that you are the chosen one. Had you been here, we know you could have done something when he was terribly sick. Jesus said, I am. I am the resurrection. Do you believe? He said, I am the resurrection. In one great day, Lord, he will come. He will be raised up again. Jesus said, I am the resurrection. Went right overhead. So he said, where is he? Where is he? Where is he? They said, well, he's there. Let's go down. They said, boy, Jesus' heart really must be broken. He wants to go down and see where they buried Lazarus. So they went down and people all followed him. The people that are in that crowd, they all followed him. And then he said to them, remove the stone, get it out of the way. They said, oh Lord, he's been dead now 4 days. If you came on the third day, he might have been able to do something because they believed that the Holy Spirit, their spirit of the person would hover around. But after 4 days, that spirit would be gone. You might have had a chance to do something, Jesus, if you got here a day earlier. Jesus says, roll the stone away. Lord, he'll stink. So they moved the stone away. And all he said was, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus come walking out of that tomb. See, that's who was coming down this road. That was him that they were praising. It was him who we said that we asked him to come into our life, that we believe that he died for. It was him that said to each and every one of us, come forth. And when you put your faith in Christ, you immediately came to life. Because it tells us that when we have sin in us, what is that we are dead. Because of our trespasses. We are dead because of our sinful nature. But when Christ comes into your life, immediately you come to life. He said to each and every one of you who have put your faith in him, come forth. And immediately the Holy Spirit came into your life. Lazarus came out of that tomb. And Jesus said, loose him. Loose him. And he said that to us as we've been looking at the scriptures. He was saying, what? Break the chain. Break that chain because I am the chain breaker. I am able to set you free. That's who was coming down. And they began to praise him. They began to say to him these great and wonderful things. And yet some in the crowd said, who is it? I'm saying to you this morning, do you know who Jesus truly is? Do you know who he is for your life? For the circumstances, the situations you find yourself dealing with day in and day out, do you believe that he is able to take our hearts that are hardened and begin to soften them up and show us how to love in the way that he has loved, to forgive as he forgives, has forgiven us? Is he able to restore joy of his salvation back into our souls? When you think about the happier times in your life, do you believe that he can take you not only to that place, but to a greater place than you've ever been before? That's who Jesus is. That even when the tears were running down our faces yesterday at the service, those tears were not for Jeff. Those tears were for us, because why? The Bible says, Jesus said, why weep for me? Weep for yourselves, because why? You still got to face it. You still got to live here in this world. Jeff received his reward. There's no tears in heaven. That's what the Word of God says. There's no sad faces. And there will never be anybody saying, I've been in heaven for who knows how long. Eternity's a long time. And no one is saying, boy, I'm tired of this. I wish I was back there. There's not one loved one who has ever said, I want to come back. The promises of God. What he offers each and every one of us. And so when we see the King of Glory coming, and knowing that he is here in our place, do we begin to say, Hosanna? Do we begin to rejoice greatly? Do we begin to shout unto him with a voice of triumph? Do we begin to proclaim the good news of who he is? Jesus said that day, I tell them, the Lord has need of it. And he changes not. He is the same what? Yesterday, today, and forevermore. He will be God in every circumstance, situations you find yourself facing. And what he wants to do is reveal himself to us in such a way that no one will ever be able to shut you up when it comes to talking about your Jesus. Wouldn't it be something that someone would say about you, it doesn't matter what you're talking about, somehow they get Jesus in the conversation. Boy, go to Joe's on Fridays, boy, the fish is really good. Speaking of fish, you know that's a sign for the believers. Speaking of fish, Jesus filled the nets up one time and it almost sunk the boats. Speaking of fish, Jesus said, go down to the sea. The fish will come up and you'll be able to reach into his mouth and take out the tax money that I need and the tax money for you. There'll be some way that you'll be able to talk about Jesus no matter what somebody began to say. And they said, oh, don't mention anything now, because they just want to talk about their Jesus. And you're saying, Pastor, don't be silly. Nobody's like that. Then you've never ran into a Cardinal or a Cub fan or a Bear fan. Somehow, they'll bring up the conversation, whether they're going into spring training or going into the playoffs. Somebody will mention how they're doing. In fact, they will be able to tell you the stats of all of the players and how they're doing. They'll be able to tell you how the team is going and how they did the last time they played against that team. But ask them about their Jesus. What would they say? Well, I go to church. But that's not the question. Tell me about the stats concerning Jesus. How he's touched our lives, how he's changed us, how he's made a difference, how he's impacted our lives in such a mighty way. That's what Holy Week is about. That's what Palm Sunday was all about. It was about the story of God completing the plan for mankind. It was that God had promised and promised. In fact, the scripture in Zechariah 9:9 is a prophetic word given 550 years, somewhere around that, before Jesus enters in. And they're shouting those things unto him. They're talking about that. The scripture says that he would ride on the foal of a colt, of a donkey, one that had never been. been written on before, he fulfilled that prophecy. He fulfilled all of the scriptures that talks about what the promise of God is truly all about. And the same scriptures of promise also talks about that when he touches our lives, we become new in him. I love the fact the scripture says, though this outward man is perishing, the inward man is what? Being renewed day by day. So then at a certain age, you'll be able to jump up and click your heels together. For a second there, I thought I was going to jump up and click my heels together. You didn't even think I could do that, did you? But that's what it's talking about. That's what it's talking about. That understanding that no matter where I'm at, God is renewing us in a relationship with him. But if I don't see him as the King of glory, if I do not see him as the one riding into Jerusalem that day, I will not recognize him as my Messiah, as the one who saves. It goes on to say, yet, despite what Jesus had foretold about his mission, the people were looking for what? Gretchen said, a military leader. And sometimes I believe that we're still looking for Jesus to just fix everything. Just make it all right. Take this here and make it happen. What you're looking for is a genie, not a savior. You're looking for someone to go. You got to be old enough to remember that. But when you're looking at the Savior, you're looking at one that will meet you in every circumstance, situation of your life, day in, day out. And where you think that you lack, he will tell you you will lack nothing because of who he is in our heart and in our lives. That you will begin to live in confidence, knowing that no matter what I'm going through in this world, nothing is able to separate me from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The people didn't get it. They didn't understand it. They asked, who is this Jesus? The word goes on to tell us that when we do not recognize who he is in his and who he is in our life, it breaks his heart. It goes on to say that after all the shouting and all the things were done, it says in Luke 19:41, and when he drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that might that make for peace. Then he was saying, if you recognize who I am, you would recognize I am the Prince of Peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up barricades around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear down to the ground you and your children within it. And they will not leave one stone upon another in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation. See, I believe that sometimes, just as the people of Israel did not recognize the time of the visitation of Christ being there, I believe every day his presence is there and we're blind to it. We're still caught up in the stuff that goes on in our lives that we forget about the one who can solve any circumstance, situation. We forget about how good he is and how much he loves us. So maybe tomorrow you need to be that person that will stand in the mirror and say to that person looking back at you, Jesus loves you. Because that's what that journey was about. He wrote in telling everyone, this is God's love for you. He's sending me to die in your place. That's how much he loves you. And then you wonder, where is he at? He's within arm's reach to embrace us, to hold us, no matter what we find ourselves going through. And so the scripture says that he sent them out to gather the foal of a donkey. And if they ask you who has need of it, when you're untying it, you tell them the Lord has need of it. And so they went and they found it. And when they were untying the colt, the person said, what are you doing? They said, the Lord needs it. What he said to each and every one of us today is that what the Lord is here. I'm here. I forgive a sin. I pick you up. I turn you around. I touch your life. I'll give you peace that you're lacking. I'll be your comforter. I'll show you grace and I'll display my love. And when you're crying at night, I will dry your tears. And when you're laying there and you're thinking you're alone, you'll feel me nudge up against you and tell you, you're not alone. You're not alone. He will tell you when life begins to overwhelm you. He will say to you, cast your cares before me, because why? I care for you. It won't matter what you're going through. He says, I will be there. I will not only be walking in front of you, but I got your back. Nobody will be able to come upon you. There will be no weapon that will overtake you. There will be no situation that will not meet you there. And I will be everything you need. That's who was entering into Jerusalem that day. His name is Jesus. Amen. As we go through this week, let us be mindful. God had a plan, and his plan is in full bloom even now. You might be having some difficulties with your health, but he's got you. He's holding you. He'll be your strength. He says, we'll get through this. It may be a while, but I'll walk with you through all of the situations you go off. Be with you in therapy. I'll be with you in your recovery. I'll be with you. Lord, I'm in a lot of pain, but it takes a little pain to get the healing process done. We don't know why these things happen to us, but they happen to us. But he says, I'm there, and I'll be your strength. I will hold you. I will guide you. And when your heart feels like it can't take no more, he says, I got you. I got you. And I got this. I will be God with you in the midst. This pain is so terrible. He said, then focus on me. I remember when my children had gotten hurt at times, and they'd be crying and weeping, I would say to them, look at me. Just look at me. Just look at me. And all of a sudden, the tears would begin to stop, and the heavy breathing, the whimpering would begin to slow down, because while they're looking at me, that's what Father was saying to us. When you're going through something, the pain of life is so hard, he just says, look to me. Look to me, and I will be God in your life. As we stand to our feet, if you're here this morning, and you've not looked into the eyes of Jesus, to know that he loves you, that he's forgiven of sin, today's your day. For he has come into this place. In fact, the word of God says, where two or three gather in my name, there I shall be also. So he's here in this place. And he will meet you no matter what you're going through today. He will be God in your life. But you have to be willing to say, Lord, I surrender it all to you. And unto you, I lay it all down. And you will find that he will pick you up. And he will place you upon his rock. And you will praise him and thank him. Because why? Lord, I wish I would have done it sooner. The question is, it doesn't matter about that. It's the fact that you've done it now. And so wherever you're at this morning, if you need prayer, we'll pray with you. If you just need a word of encouragement, we'll meet with you. But we need to know today that everything that needed to be done, Jesus has done it. And it is ours. It is ours to have. So as we sing this song, let the Holy Spirit lead you. If you need prayer, if you've never known Christ as your personal Savior, today's your day. He is here in this place. Let us sing.
Praise him for who he is, for he is worthy of all our prayers.
Let us always be ready to tell someone why we love Jesus. And if you're not sure, he says in Scripture, you love me because I love you first. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time. We thank you, Lord, that you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. You are the Prince of Peace. You are the great I Am. And Lord, and we ask you now, Lord, to go with us. Prepare our hearts, Lord, as we gather, Lord, this week. As we come together, Lord, on Thursday and Friday. And then we rejoice, Lord, next Sunday, because you are alive. We ask, Lord, that you be with us, Lord, in the busyness of life. And let us be mindful, Lord, that no matter what we're going through, you are there. We give you praise. We give you glory for this day that you have given to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everybody give a shout out to the Lord this morning.
You don't want it to sound.